Hi everyone, and welcome back to the channel. Today, I'm going to be doing a flight from New Orleans Lakefront Airport over to Ocean Springs, Mississippi. But before we get started, first and foremost, I want to say many prayers out to everybody who is going through these monster storms. These things have been really, really bad, you know. So prayers out to everybody out there in North Carolina that's going through all of that, you know, Asheville there, you know, it's really bad, you know, and then Florida, the Bend of Florida was just hit by Hurricane Helene, Cat 4. And now you got this thing here, as you can see, Hurricane Milton, you know, Cat 5 and going to be a 4 when it hits. Right through here. So yeah, lots of prayers out to everybody who lives in Florida. I am in South Mississippi, you know, Mississippi Gulf Coast, and I've been extremely lucky these past 4 years, but I'm no stranger to hurricanes, not at all. And in fact, that's what I'm gonna do on this flight. When I take off from New Orleans Lakefront Airport, fly over to Ocean Springs, I'm going to talk about my experience and the things I've went through with hurricanes. So it should be a fairly interesting story if you want to stick around and hear it, okay? But we're going to do a little flight out there, and I'm going to take off. You can set it up right now, okay? And I'll just pick, how about parking spot 81? And I'm going to pick this airplane here. Let's see. Let me make sure it's selected 81 here. Okay. I got the MAL MX-7180 STOL for this flight. Okay, and I'm going to go right on over here to Ocean Springs. And I'm going to talk about some things along the way. And I might actually break up the video so it doesn't last too long. I mean, it's a little bit of a flight there, as you can see. So you're probably thinking about an hour long flight. But in this plane anyway, I could select a different plane. You know, I'll tell you what. Let's do that. Let's pick something a little bit faster, okay? Let's go with one of these jets. How about... that way I won't break up the flight at all. I've been liking this RV-10. And I think I've already mentioned that in another video. Little plane was sitting in my garage, in my hangar for so long, and I didn't take it out and fly it very much. And recently I've been doing that, and it's been fun. I'll tell you what we're going to do. Let's take the Honda Jet, okay? Let's take the Honda Jet. I'll go with, let's go with the blue livery here. Okay, and I'll set the weight and balance. We'll set up some things here. I'm going to set it up as I'm the only one in the plane, okay? Solo flight. And I'll put like maybe a little bit of, I'll put a little bit of cargo, nothing much. Maybe how about 10 pounds or whatever, some things that maybe want to take along, okay? So, oh wait, what happened here? It kind of reset itself. All right, let's go in. Don't know how that happened. I must have hit something. I don't know what I pressed, but anyway, okay. All right, so there we have it. It's all zeroed out, and that's plenty enough fuel for this. Okay, and I usually put a little bit of wear, so let's go with one right there. Okay. All right, so there we're gonna go now to take off from Lakefront Airport. We don't want runway 36. We want parking spot 81 is what I picked. But you know what? Jets usually tend to take off in different spots. So let's go ahead. Let's pick over here. I noticed at the Lakefront Airport, a lot of the jets will kind of be parked right over here. Okay, so live weather. Okay, and this 1:10 p.m. is what I selected. All right, so I will see you all at the airport. Okay, so here we are at the parking area. at the Lakefront Airport. So I'm going to go ahead and get the plane started up. And rather than, you know, going through a whole, I'm going to go through a whole startup procedure, but I won't make you all sit through that. So let's just go ahead and get in here, and I'm going to go ahead and get it started and get things going. And I will come back when I'm taxiing. Okay, so I got the plane started up, and as you can see now, I'm taxiing on over to runway 36 left, which I believe is right here, okay? So this will be a quick taxi, and I'll be able to get right into the air, okay? And we will do some hurricane talk, okay? Some things that I've been through in the past with hurricanes. And even I'll even share a tornado story, which I did share once on my channel, you know, and I might can do that too. Okay, so I'm gonna have to kind of turn right here and hold short. And as you can see right in front of me there, that's 36 left. And hey, no taxi ribbons here. I know this airport. Yep, I used to take flying lessons here way back in early 2000. All right, let's go ahead and get the tower. Request takeoff clearance.
Lakefront Tower, November 420, Hotel Echo, ready at runway 36 left, departure to the east.
November 420, Hotel Echo, 1041 and 1-9er. East departure approved. Cleared for takeoff, runway 36 left.
Okay, we're clear for takeoff.
Cleared for takeoff, runway 36 left, 0 Hotel Echo.
So, you get your seatbelts on. Fasten those belts and we will get ready to go auto trim. Let's put that on. Let's put this on too. I normally do put those two on. Okay, and let's see. Let's go ahead now and fucking brake back off. All right. Making sure my altimeter is set. And we're going to be cruising at about 4,000 feet for this flight. It should be a short hop with this H-Jet. And I know you're going to want to hear the music. So, and I'm going to show you what I mean when we get lined up right here. The awesome music, which is the sound of a jet taking off. Okay, so get a little bit loud so you can hear that. Let's go. You always want to hear, if you're like me, the sound of a jet taking off. Never gets old. Liked it when I was a kid. I like it now. Gear up. Sailboat out there.
Zero Hotel Echo, continue for east departure.
I had one of my sailboats out there, a Hunter 33. I had it out there in South Shore Harbor for about a year. So, oh man, that Britain Norman Islander wasn't cleared to take off, huh? Alright, I'm climbing up pretty quickly here. Alright. We kind of get lined up just a little bit, and then I will put the autopilot on, and then. And let's go ahead and do that now, okay? Heading is on. Alright, let's go ahead and do that now, and vertical speed is on. Leave or not. Okay, now it's on. Alright. And we're going to climb at about 2,000 feet a minute. In 2 minutes, I'll be at 4,000 feet. Or not even. About a minute. Okay. So now let me go ahead and get my flaps up. Retract those. speed build up.
And
I'm
going
to hit the nav button once I get closer to the course.
Lakefront Tower, November 420 Hotel Echo frequency change.
And this Ace Jet is such a nice flying plane. Love it, love it, love it. Okay.
I'm going to
get this. I'm not in a rush in this flight. So we're going to try to see if we can grab the course okay now. Should pretty good. FMS, so that should do it right. Let's come back a little bit. I think we are not cruising altitude or not yet, but come on back. You can see I'm kind of reaching a high speed here already. Yeah, we're leveling off at about 4,000 feet, so this is looking good. It's a little choppy right now. A little choppy, but everything looks good, right? Yeah, this is great right now. All right, let me turn this down since the excitement of the takeoff's over, and we can just kind of enjoy the flight. All right, so hurricanes. All right, when I was growing up, my dad always talked about Hurricane Camille. And I wasn't even born yet. Okay, this was in August of 69. And in fact, my mom was pregnant with me at the time when they evacuated for that storm. And it was, my dad always told me through the years how bad that really was. And I forget the story, how he told me, you know, after that hurricane, he drove over to Bay St. Louis, and that bridge was gone. It was gone. I heard so many stories about that. The story about these people who had a hurricane party in some hotel, and that hotel was completely gone. There was houses all along the Gulf Coast from Bay St. Louis down to Biloxi or even further, where all that was left to these houses and were just the steps. And you know, I used to take rides out there with my dad, you know, many years after that, off and on, and there were still years after houses that were once there, just the steps were left. I was born and raised in Southeast Louisiana, you know, until 2020, and now I'm a resident of the Mississippi Gulf Coast, and so far been a lucky resident. Okay, so anyway, I've watched a documentary with Hurricane Camille years ago. You know, there's been more than one documentary, but I watched a documentary. That documentary said Hurricane Camille had wind gust as high as 272 miles per hour. I remember having to rewind that or something, or go back to see if I heard that right, but that's what that documentary said. In fact, they said the wind speeds were so high, the devices they had at the time could not even record those speeds at high. The highest recorded speed of Camille, I think, was 175. Now, this Milton, at one point, from what I understand, was 180, you know, but I'm thinking Camille was probably higher than that. I think closer to 200. If it had gusts that hit 272, that's really bad. And another hurricane my dad used to always talk about was Hurricane Betsy, which came up the mouth of the Mississippi River. That was supposedly a really bad one, too. It was a Cat 3. Now, when we were growing up, back in the 80s, me and my sister, and that, A hurricane that was a Cat 5 was very rare. It's like you never really heard much of Cat 5s. You know, it was always like, you know, ones or twos and things like that. So when I was growing up, I think, oh, a hurricane ain't no big deal. You know, we'd kind of go out and play outside sometimes before, you know, on a Cat 1. People didn't really have much respect for Cat 1s back then. And, it just never seemed like too big of a deal. it wasn't until Hurricane Isaac that I realized a Cat 1 is also a big problem, because that Hurricane Isaac would not leave. And just because it's a Cat 1 doesn't mean you're not going to get high winds, because I remember being in my house back then, and you could, there were these gusts, they were so high, and at one point, I'm like, there ain't no way that's an 80 miles an hour wind. That shit's at least 150 or more. Well, come to find out, guess what? There were tornadoes in the area. Because as you know, these hurricanes spawn tornadoes. And a Cat 1 is very capable of spawning a tornado, just like the other ones. And, you know, the tornadoes, that's when you're going to get those wind speeds, 100, 150, 200 miles an hour, you know? So, yeah, there was a lot of flooding in New Orleans for that season. You know, these are the two my dad used to always tell me about. My dad wasn't around. My mom died when I was 3 years old. My dad passed away when I turned 19. And they never had a chance to experience Katrina or anything like that. But I did. But I wasn't around during Hurricane Katrina. I lived out there, but I was at work. I was a driver. Truck driver, worked for U.S. Express, and I was a new driver back then. I wasn't doing it very long, you know. And I remember the night I was in Mobile, and I heard about that Katrina heading towards New Orleans. I heard about it, and I heard how bad it was. I kind of had a feeling, a really bad feeling about it. But then the next day, after Katrina came and went, I mean, I was up in Illinois, somewhere way away, you know, and it was like, the next day when I watched, I was like, well, that doesn't seem, it didn't seem like it was too bad. Oh, but that was just the beginning. Man, when those levees broke, New Orleans looked like a lake. It looked like Lake Pontchartrain, even the CBD. I've never seen nothing like that in my life, and it got so bad, you know, and if you watched any videos or seen anything regarding Hurricane Katrina, you'll know what I mean. And not just that, the Gulf Coast got slammed as well. So in my lifetime, that was easily the worst hurricane that we ever experienced. You know, and it was bad, okay? So, but from that point on, you know, there was Isaac, and there was another one too. Rita came not too long after Katrina, and that one was bad too, but it kind of hit a little west of my area at the time, you know. And now, the Mississippi Gulf Coast has really built up. They did a lot of work through the years on this area, you know. And it was so much they did, and it's like, it's finally, I think the Gulf Coast is finally back to where it was. Because I tell you what, when I seen that stuff still sitting there years and years later in the 80s from Camille, it was still sitting there, you know. And they used to have this boat that was in Biloxi, the SS Hurricane Camille. And it was up on the shore. I don't know whatever happened to it. My guess, maybe Katrina did something to it, but it was sitting there for so long. For years and years, it was always there. And then one day, I didn't see it in a while. I never really looked up on that, like what happened to it or anything, but that boat was always there when I would drive down there with my dad, take a ride with him. You know, I would always say, let's see where it has this Hurricane Camille, you know? But that's, you know, how to Gulf Coast, they just progressed from that point. They rebuilt, and it took decades, and then talking just years, decades, and just like New Orleans is still, there's some areas that are still messed up with Katrina, still, you know, and not just that, they had that tornado, that big tornado that I mentioned earlier before I took off, that big, I think it was EF3 or 4, that came out of nowhere. I believe on that day, I was working on that day. I was working. I was. I drove semis pulling intermodal containers in and out of the port in New Orleans and, you know, place like that. We go out to Mississippi, Alabama, mostly stood in Louisiana. But I'm going to tell you, I was pulling a container out of Avondale. They had an Avondale yard, you know, which is out there on the West Bank, New Orleans area, greater New Orleans area. And I'm driving, I'm talking on the phone with my friend on a Bluetooth headset. We were always talking because he drove too. So I'm on the phone with him, but actually he was off that day, but I was still talking to him. But anyway, I kept getting a message, something about tornado in the area, warning. Kept on getting it going off. Well, it wasn't all that bad, but it just kept on saying tornado in the area. I'm like, why is it going off? I'm on the Huey Long Bridge now. I'm looking all around. I don't see nothing. So I don't know why it keeps on saying that. You know how it is. You know, so I just kept on driving. And then I get off the Huey Long. I'm driving down. I believe it was Causeway. Causeway Boulevard. I'm going to get on the I-10 eastbound. And I'm on I-10 eastbound. And it still was going off. Tornado warning. Take cover in the area. Look around. Don't see nothing. Keep on driving. And I get to 610. Split. Driving on 610. And it's saying it again. You know, I'm like, man, what's the deal? You know? I don't know why it keeps on saying that. It was almost like it was getting annoying. It's like, why does it keep on saying that? You know, I'm tired of hearing this. You know, but it just kept on saying that, but I never seen anything. I got to our yard out there, New Orleans East. I parked the trailer in the back of the yard and was ready to go up front to, I did not have a trailer. I bobtailed back from Avondale, which means I didn't have a trailer. So I'm in the back of the yard. When I got back there, go up front, get my next dispatch. I'll go over to, it's a local driver, you know. So I'll go over to the back of the yard to hook up the, you know, another container, 40-foot container, to get it weighed for overweight to bring it to the port. Back there hooking up, and then all of a sudden my phone goes off again. Tornado warning in the area, take cover. And then guess what? It did it again, but this time was different. It said in caps, imminent danger. I'm still on the phone with my friend now at the point. I'm like, man, hold on. I said, man, why is my phone doing it? Saying imminent danger. I looked up and I looked to the west, and there was this monstrous tornado coming right for the spot I was standing on. So here I am. I'm hooked to a trailer. It's overweight. Landing gear is not up. Okay, day cab, Freightliner. And I'm looking at that thing coming towards me. The landing gear was up already, okay? And I was hooked to this container. So, the only thing I can think of is to get out as soon as possible, because I was standing in the direct path of this monstrous tornado. One of the first times I've ever seen a tornado. So, the fastest thing to do was to hook up the airlines. So I hooked up both the airlines, got in that truck, and got the hell out of there. Overweight truck, and I've never went through those gears so fast. You know, and there was a driver coming into our yard with a container and headed to the backyard, and I told him, do not go back there. There is a tornado back there. He literally froze, and I was like, I'm getting the heck out of here. So I just went straight out the yard in heavy container, and I could feel that wind just blowing on. I got on at that highway and did a U-turn and was worried that my wheels were going to get stuck in the mud off of that highway. And the whole while I'm driving on this highway, I'm looking to the left, and I'm telling you, just maybe about 3 or 4 blocks away, that tornado was like right there, going parallel. I didn't know which way it was going. I just assumed it was going to continue heading east, but actually it was starting to turn to the southeast, which was where I was at. So I did a U-turn with that truck, and I'm telling you, I floored that truck as fast as it can go. I floored it and headed west, and always told myself, if I'm in a position where there's a tornado around, there's a vehicle nearby, I think I can get away with it. You know, just get in the vehicle and get away. You know, the truck, not fast, obviously, heavy overweight container, but it was heavy, you know. But anyway, I was able to drive down that highway as fast as I can, and finally I got to a position where I felt that was going to be okay. But talk about scary stuff, you know. And that's the only time that I've ever really faced something like that. I remember thinking that, hey, I'm not gonna, I just didn't know what to do, you know. I've never been in a situation like that before. And so basically, long story short, I do think that my cell phone probably played a part in saving my life that day, you know, because I don't know if I would have made it had it wasn't going off. I wasn't looking for a tornado, you know, even though it said that. I mean, but in the past, we didn't have things like that, you know. We didn't have access to stuff like that in the past, you know. So, you know, people always talk about cell phones, you know, all this social media stuff. Yeah, I agree. It gets kind of old and it's kind of a pain sometimes, but look at the advantages of cell phones, though, now, you know. They can actually do wonders as far as saving life. There's the airfield right down there. I'm just going to kind of come out south because I was talking, got a little caught up in what I was talking about. But anyway, no problem. But yeah, a cell phone is not always bad, you know, because had I not had that cell phone, if you rewind this years ago, I'd have been just in a truck just hooking up to my landing gear, and man, that tornado would have been on top of me. Or I would have been in the air, 200-300 feet flying in the air, you know, and not even know what the hell was going on. You know, because I sure could, you know, people say you can hear those things. I didn't hear nothing. Only thing I heard was my cell phone going off, you know. So, I mean, yeah, that was, it was crazy. But hurricane season is started in June 1st and ends November 30th. So, I'm just hoping that we here can make it out of, I'm hoping we can make it out of this season without getting anything major, you know. And these storms have just been so bad, you know. So let's go ahead and get these flaps down and ready for landing. Get it plane slowed down as much as I can. I think I might have been a little bit too far out, so let's get it turned in a little more. And I'm trying to get a little bit lower now. We're going to try to get down to about, let's keep descending. So, yeah, I'm just kind of keeping everybody in Florida, just keep those people in your prayers, because, you know, one day here out in South Mississippi, we might not be so lucky, you know. And I don't want to see that thing go to anybody, you know, much less over here, you know. I don't want to see no one go through any of that kind of pain that these things bring, you know, all of the flooding, and, you know, and you lose so much stuff. I cannot tell you the things that were lost in Katrina. I lost track of it, you know. We lost a lot of stuff. I even had a vehicle. I had a nice Chevy Silverado back then, and what happened with that truck was you know, water got to the door. The insurance company didn't total it, and then guess what happened? Not long after, I had to put a rebuilt transmission in it, because my transmission
autopilot
basically was failing on that truck, and it happened. It only had about 70,000 miles in the guy over at the transmission place. He told me, oh well, that the water got up to the bottom of the door, then it's very possible that that could have been what won the transmission. I mean, you don't hear about transmissions going out 1, in pickups 000. Like that. At least I never did. You know, that new, you know.
500.
So yeah, that that was the result of having water get to the bottom of my doors in my pickup, and I didn't expect to have to change that, and that cost a good chunk of change to swap the, well, to rebuild that transmission.
200.
And that was shopping around, and I still, you know, had
100
that much to spend on that.
50. 30.
Man, I'm coming 20, in kind of fast, huh?
10.
I better get them brakes on, man. This joke is coming in fast. But she'll stop. I got enough room. So by the time you all see this video, I'm sure that that hurricane is up with off. Maybe be really close to making landfall. Trying to get it turned in. Well, not like that, though. We don't want to do it like that. Just ease on to it a little bit. So yeah, relatively quick flight here with the Honda Jet, and that's just taking my time. And I knew it would be a successful flight. Nice modern jet, easy to fly, you know. Yeah, it's like, you know, these hurricanes, they come, I mean, and then destroy everything, and then it takes years, sometimes decades, to rebuild. Decades. And it's not always the wind. A lot of times it's the water, the flooding. That's what happened in Katrina. It was all the flooding that really took its toll. But that's the disadvantage of living on the Gulf Coast. The beach is about a 5-minute drive from my home. So, you know, that's what you pay. That's the trade-off, I guess, for living near water, is that you're going to have to worry about hurricanes. Can't find a good speed. I don't want to keep it at without getting it too fast. Alright, we'll shut the plane down now. Alright, let's go ahead and get things turned off. Which is pretty simple on this plane. I believe I gotta control this from the inside, I think. From the control. But anyway, okay, so that concludes this flight, and like I said, just keep all those people in your prayers, because I'm sure they're gonna need it. You know how it is. You know, days later you're gonna see videos and stuff on TV, cars underwater, houses, you know, and Asheville, North Carolina, I heard some really bad things. It was something they said on a video where just bodies, people that had died, and they said the smell was just so bad out there. Which said that's really disturbing. When I heard that, I'm like, man, that's bad. You know, and I think the death toll out there is up to about 230. And you know, a lot of people don't always have the means to evacuate, and that's the problem. It's like, you can detect hurricanes a lot sooner than you can tornadoes, but, you know, even if you didn't know a hurricane's coming, you may not have the means to evacuate. Some people may not have, they may just not have the money or something. You know, not everybody might not have the money to evacuate. It gets expensive. You got to pay for hotels for days on end, you know, and you got to eat out, and that stuff starts adding up, and then all of the gas, and then a lot of people have animals, and a lot of hotels don't want animals, and I can go on and on, you know. So there's a lot of reasons why people don't evacuate. They sometimes just are not able to, you know. So hopefully, I've also heard some stuff out there in Florida just recently. You know, this might have been earlier this evening. I guess about 8 o'clock or so. How people were running out of gas while trying to evacuate. So they kind of like on the interstate, just out of gas or wherever, or on side the road somewhere. I mean, I hope one's stuck out there when this thing comes. You don't want to be stuck on a road when a hurricane comes, any hurricane, much less a Cat 4 or 5. That would have to be pretty frightening to be stuck out there, especially at dark. You know, when it's dark and you can't see anything, and a lot of times these hurricanes, like this one's supposed to hit tomorrow evening, which is kind of like later this evening, because we are October 9th right now. Yeah, so I'm hearing about 8, 9 p.m. I don't know if that's changed or not yet. So, but those of you, if you're somebody who lives in Florida, you know, in that area that's supposed to be impacted, I'm hoping that you're able to get out, and I'm hoping it's not so bad for you. Hoping you might be one of the lucky ones to get out without a whole lot of damage or whatever. So, okay, well, that's it for this video. And let me know in the comments below, have you ever had any experience with hurricanes? Like, which ones, you know? Or do you live near the South or the Gulf or anywhere? You don't have to live near the South Gulf Coast. You can just live on the Atlantic Coast. I mean, look what happened recently, you know? You can live in the northwest part of North Carolina and still be affected by these things. And sometimes when these hurricanes move inland, it doesn't mean like they're over with. Oh, it's just going to be a Cat 5 tropical storm. They start spawning tornadoes far inland, like in Tennessee and places like that. It's like, man, where do you have to move to get away from these damn things? Do you have to move to Nevada, maybe? Maybe Nevada? You think the Midwest, maybe? Maybe, I guess. I don't know. So, all right, well, let's hope everybody comes out okay from that, but I'm sure there's going to be some casualties, but hopefully it's minimal. All right, I hope you all enjoyed the video. Just smash the like button, and if you're not already subscribed, go ahead and hit the subscribe button, you know, because I'm going to be having more content coming out. So thanks for watching, and until next time, bye for now.